Hello all. Today we will start with the very first module, which is semiconductor diodes and its application. To start with the module, let us have some prerequisites, like let us understand what are semiconductors, so why do we need it, and little basic properties and basic knowledge about the semiconductors. So this is only a introduction part. So first thing, what is a semiconductor? Before going to what is a semiconductor, let us analyze. There are three types of materials. So all the materials are classified under three sections. The first one is conductor, insulator, and the other one is semiconductor. So what is conductor? Conductors are the elements, or they are the materials that allow the electric current to pass through it very easily. So it will not have opposition force for the current flow. So it allows the current to flow through it. So it is called as conductor, and the resistance of the conductors are less. Example of conductors are metal, salt water. As you know, copper wires, so they are used for the conduction, and also gold, silver, they're all good conductors of electricity. Next is insulator. Insulators are the materials that offer resistance for the flow of conductor. They offer high resistance. So here the resistance is very high. So the resistance is very high, so that the insulator will not allow the current to flow through it. So it will block the current. So because it blocks the current, it will not allow the current to flow. We can say that the resistance of these materials are very high. Next is semiconductor. So these are the conductors, or these are the materials that have the resistance in between these two types of materials. And like, so when I take a semiconductor, the conductivity of this semiconductor lies in between conductor and insulator. They offer moderate amount of resistance, not like conductor, it has less resistance, not like insulator, it has very high resistance. It has moderate amount of resistance. It will allow the current to flow through it with offering the resistance, it has resistance. So example of semiconductors are germanium, silicon, gallium arsenide. These are the three major examples, or three major materials which we use for the manufacturing of semiconductor devices or semiconducting materials. So germanium is an element, silicon is an element, gallium arsenide is a compound. So normally we make use of silicon. So normal diodes or normal semiconducting materials are always manufactured using silicon. This is because silicon is abundantly available, and also there are few properties of silicon that uplift from germanium and gallium arsenide. So silicon is abundantly available. So in the form of, that is silicon, whatever we call it as silicon, it is present in the form of silicon dioxide. So what is silicon dioxide? It is nothing but your sand. So the normal sand, what we find. So that is the silicon dioxide. Or you can also call it as quartz. So even quartz is silicon dioxide. So sand or the silicon dioxide, through which we extract the silicon. So this is a big process. You can't extract silicon like simply. So it has a big procedure, so which is called as Zoklarski process. So using that process, we are going to extract silicon. Once the silicon is extracted, we make the silicon into different electronic components like diode, FET, SCR, BJT, MOSFET, etc. So there are several electronic components which are manufactured using silicon. So there are several electronic components that are manufactured using silicon. So this is the basic introduction of silicon. And next, coming to the atomic number of silicon. Silicon has an atomic number of 14. So what is this 14? So you have 14 number of electrons in this. When I have 14 number of electrons, how are these electrons configured? So we know the rule how to write this. So I'm taking the same rule. So 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p2. So here the outermost electron that are in the valence band or 3s2 and 3p2. So that is why the silicon atom has 4 valence electrons. So coming to the atomic structure, this is a silicon having 4 valence electrons. So it has 4 valence electrons. I'm adding a impurity, so which belongs to group 3, that is boron or aluminium. I can add anything. So example, I'm taking boron here. I'm adding boron which has 3 valence electrons. It has 3 valence electrons and the other valence electron is not there. Only it has 3 valence electrons. So the silicon combines 3 electrons with the 3 valence electrons of the boron and the other one is left empty. So you have an empty hole here. So this is called hole. So because you have a hole here, we can say it is a positive charge. So it attracts the electrons. So it is positively charged. Hence, this is called a P-type semiconductor. The same thing if I come with the other one. So you have silicon and again 4 valence electrons. And I'm adding pentavalent impurity. A pentavalent has 5 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So these 5 electrons, 4 electrons get binded with the silicon electrons. So you have combined them. So one free electron is now ready for the conduction. And hence this is called N-type semiconductor. So this is the difference between P-type and N-type semiconductors. If you can see, this is P-type semiconductor having hole which is positively charged. And this is N-type semiconductor which has a free electron, Of course, this has a hole, but this also has an electron, but they are not charged. They are just positively, this is P-type and this is called N-type. That's all. They are not charged. They are not positively charged, neither negatively charged. They are neutral. So examples for group 5 elements are phosphorus and arsenic. Even antimony is an example here. So the next topic is, why do we want to study about the diode? So what is this diode? Why do we need to study about this diode? What is the speciality of these diodes? And what are its applications? Especially we will talk about the applications here. So now, why diode? So diode is a simple electronic device. That has many applications like rectification, clipping, clamping, voltage regulation, etc. So you can list a lot of examples and lot of applications here. So I'll restrict only to 2 or 4. Now what is rectification? We have the mobile chargers, right? So we know what is mobile charger. You have a charger. What actually we call it as? It is an adapter. So you have that box which you call it as adapter. So on the adapter, you will find, or if you just see the adapters properly, so it normally in most of the adapters it will be mentioned like what is the input voltage to that and what is the output voltage. So input voltage is always AC, so it is 240 volts which is AC, and the output is always a DC. So you are converting the AC current or AC voltage into DC voltage. To this process you need rectifier, we need rectification. So once you get a DC here, the DC should not alter. Say for example, I have a charger which has an output voltage of 5 volts. I assume that it is 5 volts. Now if it is 5 volts, the output of the charger should remain 5 volt. It should not vary to 6 volt or it should not reduce to 3 volts. Right? So if it goes more than 5 volts, the device may get damaged. If it reduces to 3 volt, the battery may not charge. So there are many probabilities and possibilities. To maintain 5 volts as 5 volts, we need a circuit which is called regulator or voltage regulation. To maintain or to achieve this voltage regulation, we use a diode called Zener diode. So, even for the regulation, rectification, we need this diode. This is one of the practical application where we use the diode in our daily life. And coming to clipping, so if you see or if you have a signal like this, and a signal have a sudden spike like this. Now I don't want this spike. To remove this part of the spike or this part of the signal, I use clipping circuits, where clipping circuits are developed using diodes. Next, what is clamping circuits? Suppose you have a signal here. So this is the signal. You are getting a signal here. This is the zero axis. And you are getting the signal here. So the signal is below the axis. So now I have to lift the signal towards the axis. For that, I need clamping. I have to clamp the signal from this, some negative Y or negative Y dash value to zero value. So to pull it up, we call it as clamping. So to clamp the signal, I need a diode. So these are the practical applications where we use the diodes. So that is why we need a diode. Next is diode. So symbol and physical structure. We will study only two topics, that is symbol and physical structure. First, coming to the symbol. How is the symbol of diode written? Diode is written with a triangle and a bar in front of it. So this is the symbol of standard diode. So this part, this triangle part, shows the direction of current flow. So it says that the current is flowing in this direction. So this terminal is called anode. This terminal is called cathode. So this is anode, this is cathode. So this triangle shows the direction of current flow. And this is diode, which has two terminals. Next is the physical structure. Coming to the physical structure, diode is a sandwich of P-type and N-type semiconductor. So till now we studied what are semiconductors. We have two types of semiconductors. One is P-type, the other one is N-type. So when I place P-type and N-type semiconductor one beside the other, then it forms a P-N junction diode. P-N junction diode. So it has two layers. So one junction is there because you have two layers that are placed one beside the other. So it has one junction. So it is the junction. So it is one junction. That is, we call it as unijunction. And the current in this diode, is because of two types of charge carriers. One is holes, the other one is electrons. So it is bipolar. I repeat it. It has two layers. So it has P-type and N-type. So we sandwich it one beside the other. So it has two layers. It has one junction. You have one junction here. So because you are placing P and N one beside the other, it has one junction. And the current in this one or the current in the diode is because of both the charge carriers. That is because of holes and also because of electrons. So it is called bipolar. And look at the symbol. I said you that the current direction is only in this direction, like from anode to cathode. So the current is unidirectional. So it is unidirectional device. So it is a bilayer, unijunction, bipolar, unidirectional device. Diode is a bilayer, two layer, one junction, bipolar, unidirectional device. Normally, how does a diode work? It normally works as a switch. So in general, we can consider that diode can also operate as a switch. It operates as a switch. Coming back, So you have p-type and n-type semiconductors sandwiched between each other. You have p-type semiconductor here, you have n-type semiconductor here. Now I am placing this p-type and n-type semiconductors one beside the other. So what happens when I place this p-type and n-type one beside the other? As we know, p-type semiconductor has more number of holes. So these semiconductors, in p-type semiconductor, the majority charge carriers are always holes. The minority charge carriers are electrons. N-type semiconductor, the majority carriers are holes, electrons, and minority carriers are holes. So as we studied in the previous section, if I take the p-type and n-type semiconductor, I can see only holes here. Here I can see only free electrons. So it is true that it has holes and it has electrons more, but it has more number of holes than free electrons. Here we can say you have more number of free electrons than holes. Even n-type has holes and electrons, but which are more in count? In n-type, electrons are more in count. So even in p-type, you have holes and also electrons. Which are more in number? Holes are more in number than electrons in p-type. So I'm telling that. So in p-type, you have majority charge carriers as holes and minority carriers as electrons. In n-type, majority carriers are electrons and minority carriers are holes. Now, when I sandwich the p-type and n-type material one beside the other, we can see, or you know, that this is hole and these are electrons. So this is positively charged and this is negatively charged. So opposite polarities get attracted. So this electron start moving towards the p-type and these holes start moving towards the n-type. So they start moving. They start moving from one junction or one layer to another layer. So this movement, after once this movement get initiated, the layer becomes. So here there will be a formation of thick barrier or just a wall. So the electrons from n-type start moving towards the p-type and the holes start moving towards the n-type. So when they start moving, they reach the barrier or they cross the barrier, this junction, they cross this junction and move to the other part. Even the electrons cross this junction and move to the other part. So now if you can see, you have a thick layer or a layer of p-type holes here. And you have a layer of electrons here. So these electrons exert force on the holes. And also these holes attract these electrons and will not allow any further movement. So this exerts the force on the electrons here and will not allow any further movement of this electron. These two bind the barrier here, or they build the barrier here, so which is called as depletion region. So this region is called as depletion region. So this depletion region is made out of negative charges and also positive charges. So it has some voltage drop across this. So the depletion region voltage for germanium made diode is 0.2 to 0.3. And the depletion region voltage or the barrier voltage for the silicon will be 0.6 to 0.7. So depends on the manufacturer, it can be 0.2 to 0.3 or 0.6 to 0.7 volts respectively. So this is about PN junction diode and the barrier formation. This is how the structure will be there. So these are the two layers. To these two layers, we will connect the metallic leads. Here you will connect a metallic lead. Here also you will connect a metallic lead. We say this as negative terminal and we say this as positive terminal, which we call it as anode and cathode respectively. We call them as anode and cathode. How does the symbol we write it now? So this is how the symbol we write it. So p-type is this one, n-type is this one. So this is n and this is p. This is anode and this is cathode. So this is how we write the symbol.